Come on in, family. Come and jam with your cousin Jake Taylor today. This is Jake Taylor Jacobs Show on the Brother Ben X Podcast. Let's get it.
As the cold winds blow,
come on.
Stronger than ever. Sometimes it shakes my soul. But I know that my feet's on solid ground and I will not be moved.
Listen, go in the comments right now. Let me know that you're all right. You're surviving, Rona. This is Jake Taylor Jacobs on the Jake Taylor Jacobs Show on the Brother Ben X Podcast, the best podcast on the planet. If you jamming out, you okay in this Rona season, let me know that Rona hasn't gotten you.
There ain't no pressure. He keeps me safe and warm. Cause my feet's on solid ground and I will not be moved. No, 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 I will not be moved. I serve a God that don't just say he proves. If you feel me, then yeah, I'm talking to you. Say I will not be moved. I serve the same God. Tommy of David, and the very same God proves every time that he's able. If I hold my peace, I got a seat at the table. Yeah, I'm thinking so stable. That's how I know I won't be.
What's going on, family? What is going on, family? That was Gene Moore, I Will Not Be Moved. This is Jake Taylor Jacobs on the Jake Taylor Jacobs Show. If you guys are doing just fine, you guys are okay, and Rona hasn't gotten you, just let me know that Rona ain't got you. So I know my family's out there is doing well. And I say that jokingly, but in all seriousness, this is a really serious epidemic. And my wife had to kind of help me understand the severity of it, just simply because people don't know exactly what it is, which is bringing the hysteria when it comes to this this coronavirus. And I got my speculations that it has a lot more to do than just the virus. But we're not going to talk about that today. Here on this show today, what we're going to be talking about, I was intending to do what we talk about. We want to create a recession-proof skill sets, but I think I'm going to talk about how wealth is not transferred, how wealth isn't lost, wealth is transferred, okay? So today's show, we're going to be talking about wealth is not lost. Let me retype it in the thing. It's transferred. And it's funny because a lot of the stuff that the video that we're going to put together here in a second, it is a video that will give clarity to what I've been teaching this whole entire time, which is us understanding the importance that the stock market, like we know, probably isn't the market like we think that it is. And we're just going to kind of give some commentary. We're going to break a video down and I'm going to stop and play so we can kind of hear in context what somebody else's opinions are when it comes to the market. And why more than ever, I think we can actually still do, indestructible skill sets, because why more than ever we need to make sure that we're positioning ourselves to be able to have skill sets that are indeed what I call recession proof. And what recession proof skill sets are, skill sets that can grow or evolve or can can develop in new eras and new time periods in life. So I think it's very important that we understand what's going on, specifically dealing with this epidemic, this pandemic that we're dealing with, that's causing a lot of people to have a lot of friends frantic when it comes to their finances. We have a lot of clients that are coming to our firm that are scared. You know, they're losing $20,000, $30,000, $40,000. One of our clients lost $100,000 in the market, and they're extremely scared. They're past scared, matter of fact. And we're just trying to give people comfort to let them know that it's going to be okay. But we have to make sure that we understand the importance and understand how paramount it is to make sure that we understand what's going on. And I know a lot of us, we have, you know, a lot of our time. I know that we have a lot of our day caught up in work, just trying to survive. We can't even think, or maybe even fathom, to think about actually sitting down and learning the importance of finances and learning the importance of becoming financially literate and developing skill sets that can allow for you to be able to maneuver during this moment of crisis. But I think more than ever, this is a wake up call that this can and will happen. If we don't take advantage of it today, we will always be being taken advantage of in the future. So this is just a good point to kind of prove and see what's going on. I forgot to turn on that light right there so we can be shine bright like a diamond. And so that's what we're talking about here on the Jake Taylor Jacobs. So we're talking about some real life solutions to our financial problems, giving us some practical biblical advice that can help us be able to navigate through these tough and trying times. And I think it's very important that we stay steadfast and believe that God will deliver and that we have the ability to get ourselves out of any hole. I truly believe I truly believe that black people, if we understand the importance that we play in the marketplace, the importance that we play when it comes to this economic society, and we begin to see this as a moment to kind of pivot ourselves so that we can be able to take advantage of the marketplace. If you look at history, black people, if you look at history, we got wealthy. Watch this. We got wealthy off of doing things that most people didn't want to do, because we weren't allowed to get in finance. We weren't allowed to really get in banking. If you look at the movie The Banker, that's kind of what it was. You got your charter, and then they just found all types of ways to kind of come screw you. But when we understand that this is the moment in time that we can actually find ways to be able to generate wealth during this moment in time, is absolutely critical. And we'll be talking about skill sets that pay the bills and skill sets that get you through any recession here in a second. But I kind of want to break down a video that I want to bring to light so that we can actually get to work on breaking a video down. OK, so let me bring it up real quick. So when we break this video down, I think that you guys are going to be excited to know that is Brother Ben's teasing. Clearly, that's Brother Ben teasing. Okie dokie. I'm bringing it right here so that we can be able to see. I want to make sure that we can see. I want to make sure that you guys can actually see my screen. Let me know if you can see my screen, because I just want to make sure that everything is good and you guys are fine when it comes to that. It was supposed to already be pulled up. So we're talking about wealth. It's not lost. It is transferred. So a lot of people that are dealing with paranoia when it comes to our money situation and what's going on with our finances. But we have to understand that your money didn't get lost. Nobody loses money. Money doesn't disappear. Money doesn't disappear. Money actually just gets transferred from one person to another person. I just want us to kind of to really look at what's going on so that we can kind of play the game that we're about to play. OK, so let's get it on. Oh, baby, let's get it on. Show enough, baby. So this is a guy, his name is Gary Gunderson, and he and I actually have a lot of the same philosophies when it comes to mitigating risk, making sure that our money is in the proper places and proper perspective. And he actually put this video up, maybe, I think I text Brother Benex maybe 2 days ago. or a day ago when he put this video. I think it was yesterday. And I actually talked on this topic maybe 5 to 6 days ago. And one of our editors actually cut a video and put it on my Instagram. A video when I'm talking about what the rainmakers do, what the market people do. And I think it's very important that we understand what's kind of going on during this moment in time so that we don't find ourselves frantically losing our mind and frantically feeling out of place. Because when you know what happens, you're able to make sure that this doesn't happen to you again, and you can be able to protect yourself when it comes to that. Because we have a lot of people right now that are talking about, how we're supposed to be investing in the stock market and the market is down at discounted prices. And one of the biggest things when it comes to the stock market, and people, you know, have their own understanding of the stock market and their own beliefs of the stock market, especially if they are traders and people that trade on the market for a living. They make their money gambling. When you think about the stock market is nothing but, I like to say, a large game of poker or a large game of being in a casino, to where you just don't know what company is going to win. You just don't know what's going on. There's a lot of different variables when it comes to investing in the market that we have no understanding of. And I think that before we start investing in companies, before we start investing into market, we have to understand the importance of learning how to do due diligence. And what due diligence is looking at the scope of the business, the projection of the business, what have they done, in making investment decisions based on facts, not projections and not speculation, which is what a lot of people actually teach us when it comes to money. They teach us to look at where they're going, look at the projection, look at speculation, and they say scared money don't make money. Then they give us all these mantras that are just stupid. You know, scared money does make money. Actually, scared money, it actually analyzes companies and analyzes investments a lot better. And what's happening is a lot of financial advisors, they want us to just give up our money. They want us to just give up our money to them. And what we don't know is that the majority of these funds, they charge what we call management fees. And management fees is when you have to pay them 2% of the money that you give them. They get paid 2% on the entire fund without ever having to make money with the fund. Jake, what do you mean? Oh, I'll help you out. What I'm saying is, family, is that these fund people, these people that run funds, they make money. Majority of them, 98% of them, make money even if you don't make money. What it's saying is, no matter what's going on with the fund, whether the money's making money, whether it's whether they're successful, they're going to make money no matter what. And we're going to talk about that here as we break down this video.
Losses in the market mean the money disappeared. The money you lost is in someone else's pocket now. Like how Einstein said, energy cannot be created or destroyed. It just changes forms. The same thing is happening with your money. If the money you lost is in the hands of someone else, it wasn't truly lost. To figure out what's happening, you need to learn how money is transferred. Imagine you sit down at a poker table in Las Vegas. Now, poker, let's say it isn't your passion, but you like to play it every now and again, all right? And while you're sitting down, you hit a streak. You keep winning. It feels great. Your confidence grows. So you keep playing and keep betting a little bit more and then a little bit more, and you watch. That pile has grown. Your money has grown. Eventually, though, your luck changes. On one big hand, you lose. But hey, it's just one hand. So you keep going. But now you hit an unlucky streak and start losing. You end the night with less money than you started. As you meet up with friends and family, you tell them of your losses. But were they losses? What if there's more to the story? What if you find out later that you're playing against a World Series of Poker winner, but you just didn't know it? Now, they may have let you gain confidence by bluffing and then waited for you to have a peak emotion of greed where you thought there was no limit and then you played the hand. This isn't much different than the stock market. A big reason we have seen dramatic downturns actually has to do with hedge funds. I'll explain the basics of a hedge fund and compare them to a mutual fund that most retirement plans are kind of holding on to. I'll also break down the risk you face and where most of the return happens in the market. There's so much misinformation with the market and expectations that continue to let people down, put them at risk, and impact their lifestyle and stress. All right, let me break it down so you can take.
Okay, so before we get started, what he was talking about when it comes to the poker hand. Brother Ben said, they've been playing with them features, boy. And so So when it comes to the poker, when we're talking about the poker game, what he's saying is you go to the casino and you're making some wins, right? And you're playing poker, and you don't know that at the poker table that you got world-class poker players. And so they allow you to win a couple of hands to allow you to, like, make you feel good so that you can start, what, betting more money, putting more money to the table, pushing all of your chips, if you will, inside the table. And what happens is you get so confident that you lose a bet, or you lose a hand, then you lose another hand, then you lose another hand, then you lose another hand, and they just say, oh, that's just a losing streak that you're on, you'll get right. And a lot of us black folk don't know a lot about poker, but what we do know is the casino. Lady at the casino, boom, 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 mm. She lost all her money. Lady at the casino. Come on. Yeah, yeah. You gone? Okay, so what it's saying is, like, we go to the penny machine, we play the slapjack, we run the dice game specifically, and we go to the casino, and we hit a couple of times, and you say, man, I hit, I'm winning, I'm good, everything's amazing. Oh my gosh, you don't really know what you're doing, nor do you know how you hit. You just, like, luck of the draw. You say, man, when I go to the casino, I'm expecting to lose. And then when you win, you're shocked. You're shocked and you're excited. So then what do? You pull out, you don't gamble anymore, and then guess what? You get the urge. That urge comes back. So you made $1,000 that first time. That urge come back. And the next time you go to the casino, you lose seven straight times, losing $1,000 a piece. So you made $1,000 one time in the casino. No, because they allowed you to hit one time, you're going to come hit again, and you're going to lose $7,000. And the only thing in your mind is going to say, man, if I can just get back to me making that $1,000 again. And you don't even take into the account how much money you lost over the period in time that you actually were putting your money. So when it comes to, you know, the stock market, we like to compare it to the same thing. You think you're playing one game, but you got world-class poker players that are playing a total different game on the other side, leaving you, myself, other people as common stockholders at risk, okay? So I think it's very important that we understand that and we continue to move forward.
Take back control of your money and question the advice of weather the storm. You're in it for the long haul, or that the market's on sale, or that it's time to buy. Well, is it? Are you sure? How do you know? Here are the three pieces to how money's transferred. One, there are major limitations to mutual funds. Now, there are index funds, right? Those are really low costs and they're not managed. There's also managed funds, which have usually a higher fee associated with them, or even ETFs or exchange traded funds, right? Those are, once again, very inexpensive as well. Now, in turbulent times like these, they all face major risk that will create losses for the average investor. But once again, those aren't necessarily losses. Think of those more as transfers. Growth funds have to stay in growth, even if it doesn't make sense. They're limited to fund objectives. Those fund objectives spell out how they have to invest. Now, even if the fund manager knows differently and thinks it's something that they should move to, like cash or something non-growth related, well, they can't. If they do, they get...
So what he's saying right there is when you put your money in these funds, like a growth fund, number one objective is to put your money in high risk assets, things that can make you a lot of money, but it has no protection. Even if these fund managers know that you are about to get crushed, do you know that because of how they set up the fund, they can legally allow for you to get crushed. So what I mean by that is, you know, you got people like Dave Ramsey say, just put your money in the growth mutual fund, you'll be just fine. And those growth funds, they are high risk. They can be extremely lucrative, but over, you know, you're talking about these mutual funds, only 1% of mutual funds outperform the market, S&P 500. So what's happening is you got your money in these funds that have these fund objectives. And when they have these fund objectives, what happens, it puts your money at risk, because even if they know that the market is about to crash, they do not and cannot move your money from one place to the other. There was a article that I kind of spoke on maybe a couple of shows ago, and I brought up how, or a video on Instagram, I brought up how a fund manager actually got fired for saving their client's money. The fund manager knew that a recession or a big hit was about to come, and he moved all of his clients that are in a specific portfolio and moved them to bond, safer bets, and he got fired for saving their money. He got fired for saving his investors' money because it was against the fund's objective. And so what happens with these funds, these management companies make 2% on the fund no matter what. Then they get their 220 split, which means they charge you 20%. Then they get a capital gains or what they call carried interest, the 20%. And then they get to participate in the 20% after this, call it 220. So they charge you 2% to manage your money. Then if it's against the fund's objective, which means if it's a chance for you to save your money and somebody moves your money to save it, if it's against the fund's objective, that fund manager will get fired for saving your money. I bet you didn't know that. I bet you didn't know that when it comes to these fund managers and with these objectives, when it comes to these objectives, when we're putting our money into the market, these 401ks, these IRAs, these mutual funds, see, your investor, your advisor is not telling you that when they put your money in a specific fund, you are held to the rules of the fund. And I would presume that if I were a fund manager, I will want everybody's money in growth funds, because what it does, it puts all of my investors' monies at risk and I don't have to offer any guarantees to protect their funds. And do you know what happens? Then they tell you, when you're mad that you lost your money, they tell you that you had the chance to look at a prospectus, which means that they showed you the money, they showed you the investments, they showed you the companies, and you decided as a willful investor to give your money to them. How screwed up is that? How screwed up is that? And so what we're doing, literally what my firm has been teaching people literally for years, and now it's just coming to light, and I hate this, at the expense of a lot of people's retirement and investments. What we have to understand is that we got to check twice. It's making a list. We're checking it twice. We're going to find out if these advisors are nice. I said, are we going to see where our money is going? Ba-boom, ba-boom, boom, boom. I know when you are lying. I know when you tripping. I know when you trying to get my money, but I will not let you into my portfolio. We got to understand how it goes. So we got to understand, y'all, family, that as long as we keep giving a blind eye to these financial advisors. Now watch this. When the financial advising hedge fund market for people who take our money is 90% Caucasian white people, 90% of the people that we give our money to, the people that we trust with our funds, are white. They're white. Now, Jake, what does that have to do with anything? Well, they don't know your struggle. They don't know how financial independence is important for you. They don't know. They don't know the struggle, the true struggle as a minority, a black person in America. And you know, when I look at, because we will start a fund that will charge no management fees, and we're going to show blacks how we can band together to be able to lend and finance other companies and real estate companies. We'll be launching the fund at the end of the year. But when I look at the marketplace, I see that there's a lot of people in the fund industry that literally make fun of blind investors. They make fun of us, y'all. They make fun at blind investors, and they high five their advisors for not teaching you completely the right thing. Because the moment you sign that prospectus, the moment that you say that you understand and that you willfully agree to the fund's rules and regulations, you know that you're the one at risk. As long as the fund does exactly what they say that they're going to do, they do not have to make money. They can actually lose money and still make money the entire time. They can actually set parameters and things in place, like Grant Cardone and other people who actually tell you that you can't withdraw your money out. You can't get out the deal. You can't get out the deal. So not only is your money locked, not only did you not really understand where the money was going to go, not only those things, now you're at risk and your money's gone. And they sent their kids to Harvard. Let's continue.
In the 90s, Jeffrey Vinnick moved a bunch of the Fidelity Magellan Fund out of growth stocks because he thought there was going to be a dip in 1998, which there was in October. When he moved it, well, he was fired. Fidelity was
sued. Hold on, family. Let's play it again. I forgot he talked about this.
In 1998, which there was in October, when he moved it.
So what he's about to talk about real quick, he's about to talk about the exact same thing I talked about, how somebody got fired in 98 for saving clients' money.
Fund out of growth stocks because he thought there was going to be a dip in 1998, which there was in October. When he moved it, well, he was fired. Fidelity was sued. And there were problems. The other problem that mutual funds have is there's fees. And you're paying those fees whether you make money or not. So because they're kind of subject to having to stay in growth, even when that's not the right time, it limits their ability to manage risk. See, the overall stock market averages are skewed, and it comes down to hedge funds and options trading. Now, whether that's options trading as derivatives or what are called calls and puts and things like that, we'll talk more about what that means. See, a hedge fund, it doesn't have to rely on the stock market going up in order to make money, but mutual funds typically do. Now, to get in a hedge fund, you've got to typically be an accredited investor, which means you have a certain amount of income, like $1 million or higher every year, or a certain net worth. And there's usually a minimum investment. A lot of the minimum investments are $1 million. Some of these like lower tier hedge funds might be $100,000. But look, a lot of the lower tier hedge funds lose a ton of money because they're not really managed by the highest talent. So hedge funds typically aren't as liquid as a mutual fund, meaning that you might have restrictions and you can't just sell at any time. They're also much more expensive than mutual funds, definitely much more expensive than index funds or robo funds that we hear about, where you got, you know, the kind of the robot managed funds and you know, algorithms and stuff. But look, a lot of hedge funds don't actually outperform the market. But the
notice what he's saying, family. A lot of hedge funds do not outperform the market. Keep listening.
Few that do, especially during times like these, end up with a lot of the retirement plan money that is so-called lost. Going back to options, derivatives.
Hold on, we got to replay that now. Pay attention, pay attention, pay attention. The reason why I'm having him talking, I'm giving commentary on this, because if you just hear from me, it's just your cousin Jake telling you. But if I can prove what I've been teaching from somebody else teaching it, maybe that you will see what's going on. Listen to what he said. Hedge funds. Let's listen.
Perform the market. But the few that do, robot-managed funds and you know, algorithms and stuff. But look, a lot of hedge funds don't actually outperform the market.
Wait, you heard that right? Write that down. A lot of hedge funds don't actually outperform the market.
But the few that do, especially during times like these, end up with a lot of the retirement plan money that is so-called lost.
Woo! Cousin Jake, you putting me on game. Cousin family. I'm trying to put you on game. The money, family. Oh my gosh. The money doesn't disappear. Money can't disappear unless it's burned. Matter of fact, the government and the Federal Reserve, they print more money. So when you're losing all of your money in those retirement funds, please believe that it's not because the money is disappearing. The reason you're losing your money is because,
going back to options, derivatives, and you've probably heard of futures, right? Because you see like what's happening in the futures market starts to let us know what might happen when the market opens. So let's say that an option could be a call. That means someone thinks the market's going to go up and they might buy on margin, or they might say, okay, if it goes up, you're going to get an even bigger return. Or a put is, hey, we think it's going to go down. So you might even hear terms like it's something short or long. Short means selling short is, hey, we've borrowed these funds, and when the market goes down, we get the gains as a hedge fund, and everybody else takes the losses because they were long. Short means we think it's going down soon. Long means we think it's going to keep going up. So If you're looking for stocks that are likely to decline, well, that's when you'd want to short sell it, right? You borrow those shares from someone else who owns them. You sell the shares and then make money by later replacing the borrowed shares with others bought at a much lower price. Part of the major downturn was a lot of these hedge funds selling short or selling positions, and they have so much money that it actually moves the market. Now, options are...
Smooth operator. What'd you say, cousin? I said smooth operator. These funds are smooth operators, family. I'm telling you. And so what happens when you see big changes and big shifts in the market, you can pretty much guarantee that the weatherman, these fun weathermen, $5 for the 45 in my other hand. Listen, these hedge funds, family, they're moving the market, causing us common stockholders to want to anticipate or literally be controlled by the weather that they create. So if a hedge fund wants to make money, all they got to do is start selling shares and getting options, selling those options, making the market move so they can make double and triple the money on the other side. So when we talk about where's my retirement, where's my money, where's my income, where's this going, at all those things, family, please understand something. And I'm trying to be as clear and as what's the word I'm looking for? Concise and precise as I can. Your money isn't being lost. That money has been transferred to a much more wealthier person who knows how to manipulate the market for their best benefit. So us as common stock and shareholders, with that little $100, $200, $500 a month that you spend them, that's not enough for you to actually have control of your money in your marketplace. You're literally taking the resources that you were blessed to have and literally gambling it away because you don't understand how the market works. Let's continue.
Are kind of win-lose. One person.
If you guys are getting value from this show, can I get some likes? Can I get some shares? Can I get some comments? If you guys are getting some value from this show.
Bets it goes up. The other one bets it goes down. One person ends up with the money. The other person loses the money. Or if the market goes down and you're like, wait, but I bought when it was worth more, and then you sell, whoever you bought from is the one that made the money and you're the one that took the loss. Look, George Soros is a pretty legendary hedge fund investor, and he got annual returns exceeding 30% for more than a decade while the market was only going up 6-8% during that time. That means the average investor isn't getting what this multi-billion-dollar fund is getting. He also shut down a fund in the year 2000 when things went south in the market. Once again, there's, you know, win big, lose big. So let's go back to that analogy. These hedge fund managers are the best in the world. They're the World Series of Poker champions. They're making different bets than the people that are just in it for the long haul and dollar cost averaging and putting their money in a mutual fund for the next 30 years. Plenty of managers, there's plenty of them, but only a few that are amazing and that get the majority of the large returns in the market. See, they have enough money to potentially move or impact the markets like I mentioned. When they sell positions, you can see the market go up or down while their accounts are changing. They're not limited to making money only during growth times. All right, the second thing here is there's average.
So when people say, you know, so when people are coming and they say, hey, listen, you know, everyone's losing right now. They're lying to you. They're lying to you. Listen, the reason why these funds want us to continue to put our, especially these trash 401ks. I've never heard of a prison sentence so ugly that people literally believe what these people, it, oh my gosh, they tell us, family, to put our money into this qualified plan for 30 or 40 years. They're going to penalize us if we access the money too soon. Then they tax us when we access it. We can borrow against it, but that money can't continue to make money when we borrow against the policy. And then if we don't take it out soon enough, they penalize us 10% for not taking it out soon enough. And then they tell us that we can't touch it till 59 and a half. What in the hell are you doing with my money for 59? It's my money. It's my resources. It's my bread. So I don't understand how media has really proven to us that a 401k is the best place to put your money. Because the only people that I see getting the benefit out of that are the fund managers, the banking systems that make money on transactions, and they make listen, y'all, family, the government's making money even when you're deferring your taxes. Why? Because when the fund managing company, when they make gains on your money, they have to pay capital gains tax on that money. So they're getting their taxes on that money being moved around. And then they tell you that you don't have to pay taxes until you access it 30 years later. And let me ask you a question. Do you think that taxes are going to be higher later or lower later? Do you think that taxes are going to hit you for more money later or less money later? You don't have any kids. Let's say your house is paid off. You took care of all of your debt. You have no write-offs. Taxes is going to whoop your behind. So we literally got a partner that says, you're going to do all the work. You're going to put all the money into this fund, and I'm not going to tell you what I'm going to tax you later. While we're getting our ass whooped in these mutual funds, excuse my language, I just get upset. We're getting whooped in these mutual funds and these 401ks and these funds. We don't know where our money is. We don't know who got our money. We don't know who the fund manager is. And the only thing that we know is the advisor that put us in the product, but they can't help us manage it. So when we think about the system that we are in, this is a sick system to where the government created the problem, then they offer us the solution and tell us that this is the best plan. Family, the reason why your taxes are deferred is because you didn't use the income. It's not a good deal. You struggling to pay your bills, living check to check, when 6 to 8 to sometimes 15% of your money is going to these funds who don't give a rat's ass about our black ass. We got to get to the point to where we're like, yo, this don't make sense. I'd rather anybody, any day, tax me today so I know what the tax rate is. Then I can move that money. I can put it in some type of reserve that allows my money to grow tax-free so I can make up for the loss of getting taxed today later. Come on, family. We got to understand these games that are being played. And we're getting manipulated and we're getting used by these sales people that call themselves advisors that don't know more about the market than they do just trying to recruit and hire people. These MLM, network marketing, financial quote-unquote services firms. Excuse me for getting crunk, but I get so amped up and I get so frustrated when people can't see with their own eyes that we are getting screwed beyond imagination. That we're getting screwed beyond imagination. Y'all, we not getting a good end of the stick. This is literally like Pharaoh. Pharaoh knew a problem was coming, taxed his people 20%, and then when the land got famined, then taxes people to get the same harvest that they gave him years prior. And then eventually these Egyptians, these Israelites, these Canaanites literally gave up themselves in slavery just to eat off of a system that was curated and understood that was going to be a problem in the future by Pharaoh. This ain't nothing new. If you study history, you can predict the future. especially dealing with our enemy. Especially dealing with our enemy. So you can't piss on me, sir, and tell me that it's raining. That's piss. That's piss.
Returns versus actual returns. One thing that will not be calculated for you moving forward with your retirement funds is the impact of companies that will go out of business. When that company goes out of business and you have money in today, whatever percentage of your mutual fund owns that business is kind of...
Hold on 1 second. He's about to start teaching something real quick. What he's about to start teaching is that there's a difference between averaged money on the market. There's a difference between money that you make in average on the market. And there's a difference between... There's a difference between money that you make on the market. They show you average income in the stock market, and they don't show you real rate of return. See, average is they look at all of the best. When you look at S&P 500 companies, the ones they say that you invest your money into, they never calculate the S&P 500 companies that go bankrupt. They never calculate the S&P 500 companies that fall out of the S&P. They literally just replace the fallen company with a new up-and-coming company that's eligible. And then they continue the average of the stock market like that S&P 500 company didn't just fail. That's what he's about to talk about here in a second. Hope you guys are getting value. If you guys are getting value, please like, share, comment. Please like, share, comment. Okay. Please like, share, yeah, comment. Please like, please share, please comment, because we about to go back, we get it. Go back and get it. We go back and get it. We go back and get it. Please like, please share, please comment. Let's get back into the game.
Actual returns. One thing that will not be calculated for you moving forward with your retirement funds is the impact of committed to making money only during growth times. All right, the second thing here is there's average returns versus actual returns.
This is what I was just talking about. Average returns versus actual returns. Average returns versus actual returns. Listen in close, family.
One thing that will not be calculated for you moving forward with your retirement funds is the impact of companies that will go out of business.
One thing that's not calculated are the interest rates of companies that lose you money. These are Toys R Us, bankrupt. All these companies that go bankrupt. GMC, bankrupt. Well, if your mutual fund is in those companies and those companies die, your rate of return should be reflected upon that. They don't show you that. Because if they showed you at the casino how many people win versus lose, you would never go to the casino. The only thing they show you at the casino are the people who just hit big to make you want to keep playing at the casino.
When that company goes out of business and you have money in today, whatever percentage of your mutual fund owns that business is kind of lost moving forward. But that stock that goes out of business won't be calculated moving forward. Instead, it'll be replaced with a new stock that may have growth that you don't actually get, right? Because you only bought that share through your gains or through new deposits. The money that you lost was lost. The company that went bankrupt is now gone.
That man said, the money that you lost is lost. Because that company no longer exists. Gone. Gone. The money that you lost is gone. Because it no longer exists.
On. So that makes these average returns misleading. You can have an average return of 0%, but still end up with less money than you began with. Let's look at the plus and minus there. Okay, first off, because fees might not be calculated in your average, you can have losses even at a 0% gain because you paid those fees. Volatility impacts you.
Jake, make it simple for us. Easy. Easy. What's not calculated in these rates that they give us are transaction fees, management fees, 12b1 fees, load fees, inflation fees. All of these things are what take away from our actual rate of return. So when they show you the moon, Please question if the moon that they showing you is real. Please question it.
How does volatility impact you? Well, let's look at average versus actual math. Imagine, like, you know, I'm in a shower, but there's a shower head on my left and my right. I turn one freezing cold, the other scalding hot. Those are two different temperatures, but on average, it's a lukewarm temperature. But in reality, I'm miserable as hell. So if I have $10,000 and it loses 10%, I'm now down to $9,000. If my $9,000 now gets 10%, I'm only back to $9,900 before the fees are paid. So this is part of the problem when they're talking about the market's back up 10%, but 10% of what? If the market's down 20%, getting 20% back doesn't get us back to square one. And those companies that go out of business permanently further exaggerate the average return versus the actual return. Let's also mention the mental impact of money going up or down, or impacting your personal stress, or creating all this additional concern. And it becomes a conversational distraction too, where people are now going, oh man, I've lost all this money. So like, this kind of infuriates me, because people feel, oh yeah, the market's averaged X percent, but averages and actual returns are two separate things.
Cousin Jake, you've been giving us this game the entire time. Cousin Jake, you've been giving us this game the entire time. Let me tell you something. Family, I'm trying to get us to be aware of these lies that these market folk, especially these stock market people, gee whiz, they just, stock market people remind me of, Hustle Man. You know, it's just a hustler. That's what stock market people remind me of. They remind me of, like, used car salesmen. Like, you just, like, when you see them, you want a car, but when they walk up, you act like you don't want the car. That's exactly how I feel when I'm talking to somebody about, like, oh my gosh, it is tiring. Oh my gosh, it's so freaking tiring. Especially when they talk about the market. So they say, yo, the market goes down 10%. What he was talking about was average, right? So he's saying, if you got two shower heads, one is scalding hot, like burning your skin. The other is freezing cold, like freezing your skin. The average of the hot and the freezing will average out to a lukewarm water. But you uncomfortable as hell, because this side getting burnt off and this side is getting froze off. So, your average of water heat is lukewarm, but you're getting toe up. And that's what happens with your money in the marketplace when you do not know what to do, when you do not know what's going on, when you don't understand that these people want you to stay blinded. Blinded. Stay woke. Dum, 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 baby, baby. Won't you drive? Yo, I stay woke. You gotta stay woke, people. Open up your eyes so that you can see. Open up your eyes and see like me. Open up your plans and man, you're free. Listen, so we got to understand, please. We're not done. I ain't done teaching you. Sometimes we gotta look at the man in the mirror. And you gotta ask him, stop playing with my money. So we got to get better. It's no longer an excuse. It is no longer an excuse for us it's no longer an excuse for us to continue to listen to these salespeople advisors that don't understand what the heck they're talking about. So yes, when the market goes up 10%, that doesn't mean you got your money back. Somebody else got your money. Because when it comes to investing in the marketplace, when it comes to having solid, being investors, people like hedge funds, when we start our fund, we're going to be putting our investors in place to where they're in control of these assets. So when you see people like hedge funds, big investors, they make plays in the market, they're not using $100. They're using enough money to be able to control. They're getting on the boards. They're controlling where their money is going. They're a part of the hiring process, the managing process. Why? Because they understand the importance of managing money. And we got to get to the point to where we tired of people just trying to tell us what to do. And I know there's a lot of people like, Jake, I work too much and da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-boom. But, you know, in all honesty, that's not an excuse. Let's get to it.
Do the losses in the market mean the money disappeared?
Because it doesn't take a long time. It doesn't take a long time to learn these finances. It don't take a long time. It don't take a long time at all, matter of fact. It just takes 30 minutes a day. It's 30 minutes a day. Go into absinstitute.com. Register in our institute. 30 minutes a day.
Poker champions. They're making different, but still end up with less money than you began with. Let's look at the plus and minus there. Okay, first off, because fees might not be calculated in your average, you can have losses even at a 0% gain because you paid those fees. Volatility impacts you. How does volatility impact you? Well, let's look at average versus actual math. Imagine, like, you know, I'm in a shower, but there's a shower head on my left. And my average, it's a lukewarm temperature. But in reality, I'm miserable as hell. So if I have $10,000 and it loses 10%, I'm now down to $9,000. If my $9,000 now gets 10%, I'm only back to $9,900 before the fees are paid. So this is part of the problem when they're talking about the market's back up 10%, but 10% of what? If the market's down 20%, getting 20% back doesn't get us back to square one. And those companies that go out of business permanently further exaggerate the average return versus the actual return. Let's also mention the mental impact of money going up or down, or impacting your personal stress, or creating all this additional concern, and it becomes a conversational distraction too, where people are now going, oh man, I've lost all this money. So like, this kind of infuriates me, because people feel, oh yeah, the market's averaged X percent, but averages and actual returns are two separate things. Now, if you want to learn more about this,
So, I mean, it's very easy to understand.
Even the good place that people think it is to put your trust in money. In the 90s, I think it was, the stock market had an unbelievable ride of great returns. And in 1999, there were over 400 companies that had an initial public offering, right?
Now watch this. He's talking about in 1999, there were over 400 companies that went public. That's how fire the stock market was. People, you know why people go public? Because they want other people's money that they don't have to, quote unquote, I mean, they got to be responsible for it. But I mean, it's at the investor's risk, really.
An IPO. So they went public and you can now buy them on an exchange. People really believe these double digit market returns were the new norm. When we look at how things have progressed since then, we see a very different trend. Fewer and fewer companies have gone public, with only 190 companies having their IPOs in 2018. That's a pretty big difference. The circumstances and outcomes of those companies that did go public since 1999, well, nearly half of them are no longer available for purchase because they either closed their doors, were bought out by another
half the companies that went public in 1999 are already out of business. That means that there were people who were investing money in these companies that lost their money for good.
Bigger company, or they went bankrupt. There's bankruptcy, there's scandal, there's constantly technological upheaval in the market today, right? We're seeing all this disruption. It's even more important now to avoid the speculative behavior of gambling in the stock market if we stay with this poker analogy.
So we're going to be done with him. We're going to be done with him because I think I've gotten to the point to where we understand, you know, what the point that I'm trying to make. And the simple point that I'm trying to make, family, is we got to stop being so gullible. We got to wake up. These resources that God has allowed for us to have, we worked hard. And the very first place we give our money is the bank for car notes, mortgage bills, credit cards. The next place we give our money, government. Next place we give our money, these investment funds. And we don't know one thing about money. The most important tool to learn how to use is our finances. And it just takes 30 minutes a day just to start to learn. That's why we built the ABS Institute. to re-educate your money so that you can understand not to be taken advantage of. When it comes to you utilizing your money, Warren Buffett says, rule number one, don't forget, don't lose your money. Rule number two, don't forget rule number one. Well, how on earth can a hedge fund manager, he's no longer a hedge fund manager, he's just a public company that buys public companies. But how does an investor understand a philosophy that says, don't ever lose your money, rule number one, and rule number two, don't forget rule number one? How can somebody position themselves never to lose their money? You got to start asking yourself, do I have enough money to have enough leverage to protect my interest more than I'm protecting the person I'm giving my money to? Jake, what do you mean by that? Well, if you got $500, you don't have enough leverage to tell a company to give you some assets or some type of guarantee to protect your money. But if you got $100,000, that's a different conversation that you can have. Well, Jake, how do I get to $100,000? Live like a bum. Live under your means. Get only the necessities and store the only thing that can save you. Y'all, retirement means to die. So we're not saving money for retirement. We're saving money for financial independence. Your freedom comes with a price. Your freedom, family, comes with a price. So we like to call it a retirement number. No, that's your financial independence number. As long as you feel like you got to go to work in order to provide for your family, you will never be free. Now, what I'm saying is not that the job is the master. What I'm saying is our mentality causes us to stay enslaved to the job system, needing and depending on systems more than we need and depend on the God that we serve. So we use the people that pay us for our services, even as a business owner, and you store that cash to buy your freedom to where your lifestyle is not dependent upon you working. That's even inclusive of these self-entrepreneurs, self-employed and entrepreneurs. You can be a slave to your business as an employee is a slave to their job. So we have to position ourselves to save and store cash so that we can buy our freedom, family. We got to learn how to purchase our freedom. And the question that you have to ask yourself is, how much is my freedom really worth? Don't give cliche a million. No. How much do I need to survive for 20 years on food, clothing, utilities, paying off all my debt, living as free as I can without having to depend on a job? What is that exact number? And that's why you're saving. And it should not be until you 65 before you decide that you want to be free. Your best years are behind you, not in front. You can't go to the beach and enjoy the beach like you want to. You can't travel and go missing for 30 days like you want to. You don't feel as confident in your skin like you used to when you were younger. So you live low today so that you can live high tomorrow. And most of us, with our Starbucks, with our cars we really can't afford, with our too high ass mortgage, with our alcohol or weed budget, with those five things alone, those things are costing you your freedom. They're costing you your freedom. Jake, what is freedom to you? Freedom is when my wife don't have to clean the house, because we're using our resources to pay some other black sisters a cleaning business to come and take care of our house so my wife can stay free from domestic things, to pay for a cook, to be able to fly, to be able to go, to be able to do, to not have to worry about bills, those things, not luxury cars. That ain't freedom. And some of us want luxury cars so much that you're literally willing to be enslaved for the rest of your life in debt, and having to work to pay that debt, which is what indentured slavery is. You're working for your end date, your bail date. But y'all don't want y'all cousin to talk to you today. You want your cousin, this is what you want. You want your cousin to lie to you. You want me to tell you that you're doing just fine. You want me to tell you that because you got that nice Cadillac, because you got that nice Benz, because you got that nice BMW, because you're making significant income, that that means that you're doing okay. And I'm the cousin that's going to tell you about yourself, and it's not. Income is not equivalent to wealth. Income is money coming in, but if your expenses are spitting the money out as fast as you got it coming in, you, sir, you, ma'am, are not wealthy. You are enslaved to the ideology of living like the Joneses. You are enslaved to the mentality of trying to look like I got it going on. And so because of that, you're just a high-paid slave. You're a high-paid slave. You keep doing business with the bank, and the bank ain't got your best interest at heart. Now, notice, nobody asked me. I talk about privatized family banking, how families can put money together to become their own banking system, how you can put your own money together to be your own banking system, how you can use other people's money at a much more favorable agreement than with the banking institution that was never created to lend to you, black man. Black woman. The system wasn't created to benefit you. So excuse me if I get carried away. Excuse me if I got vibrato. Excuse me if I'm saying contradicting things. But the things that we have been taught, if it was meant to free us, we would have been free for real a long time ago. The only thing that they did, they replaced shackles with mental shackles and creating debt that causes us to pay and work for them for the rest of our life. Excuse me. Excuse me that if I tell you that I'm not okay with how you living. Excuse me. Excuse me when I tell you that a mortgage ain't an investment. Just look at the numbers. You get more house than you can afford. You get more house than you can afford and little land for your kids to build on. I'd rather have more land, smaller house, so my family can have land that they can build on. We got this thing messed up, family. We got this thing misconstrued. Listening to these product pushing financial advisors that ain't got more of a pot to piss in than you do. Did you know the average financial advisor only makes $37,000 a year? You make more money than your financial advisor. And I'm tired. I'm tired of us being okay with what we're doing. You know how free it feels not to have a car note? You get lower insurance. To have a car you can afford. To live in a space that is perfect for you. Not because you want a big house. You living in living rooms that you never patronize in. You got plastic in these living rooms. You got parts of houses that you're not even using. My favorite book talks about what hoarding does. And hoarding is against God. You hoard your wealth. You hoard your money. You hoard your stuff because you want people to know you got stuff. We got to start dealing with the insecurities of our hearts. That stuff helps you feel like you a better man and woman. I'm sorry, sister. You working for things that's supposed to work for you. You working for stuff that's supposed to work for you, family. This paper. This is what we work for. This little paper. You know this is cotton. You know this is made from cotton. So they made us pick cotton. Then they ingrained in our head to work for cotton. I don't work for money. I provide services and goods for my people to give them financial liberation. And by default, I get compensated. Then I make this cotton work for me. We got $400, $500 a month car notes. And you live in check to check. You better go get your butt a cash car. You better go put $1,000 in that car. I'd rather pay $1,200 for a motor than I'll be paying $800 a month. Well, Jake, I want the best of. If you want the best of the both worlds, you want the best of everything. You need to be working your butt off. You need to be being a good steward of your resources. You need to be managing your money. You need to be empowering other people. You need to be moving your people forward, providing a service that is quality, that the marketplace will compensate you for your worth. If you really want the best of the both of what this life got to bring you. Stop doing deals with the devil because you want to live tight today. Family, we got to get our priorities together. We got to get our priorities right. And we got to understand that as long as we take their word for everything, we will always be a slave to their system. As long as we take their word for everything, we don't do our own due diligence. We don't do our own research because we're so ingrained to think about money, quick money. They didn't say having money was the root of all evil, the love of money. And it seems to me that a lot of us love money a lot more than we love the God we serve. You wake up every day. How can I go make money to pay these bills? How can I go make money to take care of this debt? How can I go make money to pay this mortgage? How can I go make money to pay that car note? How can I go make money to pay that credit card? How can I go make money to pay that student loan? You don't wake up and say, God, how can I be of service to you and your people today, God? You wake up and say, God, bank. God, Bank of America, God, Chase Bank, God, Wells Fargo, what can I do today to pay your debt? y'all don't want y'all cousin. See, y'all want me to be sophisticated. Y'all want me to be in a suit and tie. You want me to tell you how everything is going well. Just stay with the market. No, the best stock in the world is you, family. Ain't no stock better than you. Ain't no stock better than putting good food in your body. See that you get a 40, 50 more years. Ain't no better stock than investing in your education. See how much money you grow if you just take the time to stop trying to flip money and start flipping money in your stock. You care more about other people's businesses than you do your own business. You are a business. You are an organization. And your family is looking at you to make the right decision today because it's affecting them tomorrow. It's affecting them, family. It's affecting them. And we got to get to the point to where no matter what, whatever decision that we make, that we are willing, family, we are willing to not be moved. We're willing to stand 10 toes down in what we believe. And we're willing to go get what's rightfully ours. God wants us to have the best of everything. You just got to make the decision that that's something that you want to. Peace, family.
Stronger than ever. Sometimes it shakes my soul. But I know that my feet's on solid ground.